Hi, everyone. Hello. How's your energy? I know the day has been long and you have been on a lot of sessions. You probably, your head is like overwhelmed right now. People that are sitting on the back, if you could sit on the table, because pretty soon we're gonna have an exercise and I want you to wake up. I don't want you to sleep. So get on the table and we can start. This is the session. If you are not on the right session, still stay, don't go. A little bit about me. I live in Canada. That is the Canadian soldier uniform. I managed to get one just to do the picture and then I put it back and I pretend it wasn't me. I've been around in the industry, in the software development for a long time, although I don't look like, thank you. I've been changing my job often. So I've been trying, I started as a developer, that's what I did in school. And then I changed, I started as a project manager. I said, oh my God, what is this thing? And I moved to Scrum Master. I'm more of that personality person, role that fit better for me. And now I'm an Agile coach. Yeah, I speak on a lot of conferences. It is my first time in India. I'm very excited to be here. I'm very excited to talk with this crowd. You guys seem really interested in Agile and you have done some really good stuff. So I'm really looking forward to do this together because I'm interested on what are you gonna think about this session. Okay? So one thing that we're gonna do here, it's about putting the value first, right? You've probably heard it in different ways and different messages from different speakers all day long about value, putting it first, think about it, right? What I'm gonna help a little bit is how to do that. So some tools around it that might help you in a more practical way. Who's familiar with story mapping? Okay, so there are some people. Story mapping is one of the most exciting tools that I use as a coach with product owners. Usually at the beginning when we have agile teams starting, product owners are struggling on how to create now these way of managing requirements in an agile way. They are used with producing those long, big documentations, right? And they have a hard time helping the team that is trying to think small, to work agile, to do these iterations. So what about me, product owner? Who's gonna help me on how to do this? So story mapping is one of the tools that product owners really find it useful. Hi, I'm saying everyone sit on the tables, don't sit there. So if you came late, sit on the table. So, the way story mapping is created, Jeff Patton is the guy that originated this. And the way he starts is think about the goals of your application, of your solution, of your whatever you're building. And think of the goals in a sequential way. So what do you do in order to achieve something? Now, so sequential, right, from the timeline. Now, you don't do that just from the goal point of view. You want to mix that together even with the users. Because if you think just goals, or if you think just users, you don't get that context. You don't get the relations between them. And you're going to miss, you're going to miss a goal, you're going to miss a user, you're going to miss the needs of a user to achieve a goal. So you want to do this together, right? You start with the user in mind and the goal in mind and every step that you need to take in order to achieve the final product goal. And then what you do is you take the goals and you split them into activities, right? So you take that big thing and you split it into smaller ones. And then you take that each of those and you split it even more into stories. So it is going from this big story, from this big thing that we're doing, into splitting it into smaller, and then go deep into it, take one of the activities, go deeper into it, and break it down. So this is the concept. And the way Jeff uses this, it is also not just to create the sort of like the backlog of the whole project, of the product that we're building, but even to help with how we're going to do this later. So story mapping is going to be the tool that we're going to use today. And if you haven't used it before, it's wonderful because you're going to have a chance to build the very first story map in your life. How exciting is that? Okay, so we're going to do this in different steps. And during the talk, we're going to have some exercises. So you're going to build this as we go in an iterative way. Guess what? We're agile. So as an example, here we're going to go with priorities. As an example of a story mapping, here it is something that I've done before to give you just an idea. In this case, I was building an app to use a taxi. Think of it before Uber kind of world, right? So as you can see, I took these three big goals: request booking, select a taxi, and make a payment. And the users that I have there, is it you, the person that is asking for a taxi? It is the dispatcher, and then is the taxi driver, right? Can you think of any other user or any other goal that I missed? Maybe you can, if you put some more thinking into that. Payment gateway. Well, we're not there yet. We're just saying payment, right? Because payment can be done in so many ways. As you can see, is a payment estimation, is a safe in-app option, or I pay the driver, and I pay the driver cash, or I pay the driver with a credit card, or I pay the driver with the app pay thingy. So there are different ways, but I'm not there yet, right? So right now, I'm just building the top, the very first two layers. First, the persona that is you, needs to request a booking. The dispatcher can help with that. Then you move into selecting a taxi. Then you move into having the ride with a taxi driver. And then you pay and it's done, right? You arrive to the destination, you pay, that's it. Now I'm taking all of these goals and I'm breaking them down, as we said, right? We're breaking them down now into activities. For example, request booking. I can schedule time. I can choose the pickup location. And I can choose, and I have even an option if someone doesn't have a smartphone. Believe it or not, there are still people that do not have a smartphone out there. And we need them as customers too. They need to go around, right? They need taxis. Selecting a taxi, I'm splitting that into online available or online not available, right? That's how I'm seeing. And when it came to payments, we kind of looked at it. Now that I have the activities, I take them and I break them down into, I go deep. I take just one of them, right? For example, schedule time. All the things that I can think about how to schedule a time, right? So some of the options I have there is immediate pickup, later pickup, select a pickup time, or change of booking. Pick another one. No smartphone. I send a text message or I book online. Pick another one. For example, for online not available, the only option I have there is list available taxi companies to call, right? When I'm not calling from an app, I'm just going online. I need a list of taxi companies available, and I can pick one of them and I can call them. So as you can see, we take one big thing, we break it down, and then we break it down more into smaller ones. So what I'm going to ask you to do is to start getting used to this. Before I move on with how to use story mapping, I want you to actually build a story mapping, a story map. You have a white flip chart sheet on your table, and you should have also some stickies. So if tables are too big, feel free to join this table. There's still room here. Spread yourself in a way that you can fit nicely and you can cooperate. So the flip chart located, the stick is located. You should have also some pens around or pencils, right? So what I want you to do is to build your own story map. And I'm going to give you an exercise. If you are from the same organization, or if you are a team that is working on the same project, is any like that? Are you sitting, like, are you from the same team? You work together and you are sitting together? Are you? You are? That would be good if you take a project that is your own, right? I'm giving here an example, but you can make it useful. Take your own project and build a story mapping for your own project so you can take it tomorrow to work and show it to your team and say, here it is the plan for the next 6 months. For the ones that are not together on a team and then they need something to think about building a story map, what we're gonna do is we're building a training site. So think of Naresh, for example. He wants to start building a training. Like he has the conference app, he wants to build one for training. And what he wants there, those are the things that we know so far. So there will be a training admin team that will manage course description, details, booking, etc. Right? So it's going to be an admin team. We're going to need an admin site kind of things to manage trainings. The next one is going to be employees will be able to browse possible courses by category, by data, and by trainer. So as an employee, I go now to the system and I need to browse the possible courses, right? The next one, as an employee, I will need to be able to create and manage registrations and provide feedback after the training. So after I've selected the training and I've gone to the training, right? I took the training physical face-to-face with the instructor. Now I need also to provide the feedback. The next one is training admin will be able to analyze feedback and work on creating courses tailored to employees' needs. So someone, we are agile, we want feedback, right? We're not kidding here. So after we do these trainings, we want some feedback and we're gonna work on those feedback, right? So this is what we're doing here. Someone is gonna take your feedback, is gonna use it to make the courses better for the next wave of employees that want to take courses. So what I want you to do is on those flip charts with the sticky notes to start build your story map. Just to give you an idea, because the time is kind of limited and I want you to start thinking more about stories and activities and all of that, this can be the beginning. Feel free to add if you want, but this is one way to start. You have a user that is an employee and you have another user that is the administrator. And the goals are going to be manage courses, register, and then manage feedback, right? And also as an example, I'm giving you even the very first one. I broke it down for you. So what you need to do is either add more and finish the other two. Questions on what to do? Or are we all clear? Good. All right, time starts now. Go. You're going to have about 20 minutes. So start with the users and the goal, right? Before the going deep. Scared to write a sticky, put it there. If it doesn't look good, throw it out. They're cheap, right? Don't worry about it. So try. Don't be scared. Yes. Otherwise, how can you give feedback? Yeah, it's right now we're not there yet. Yeah. Do you have a lot of stickies? Do you have like 100 of stickies? Oh, come on. Do you have 50? Come on. You have 4 minutes left, right? 50 stickies. How did it feel? How did it feel to go first horizontal without going deep? I know that team had a little bit of struggle with that, right? You started going deep. Any other team that had, you guys were a little bit also, you started going deep on one. So is it a little bit different, this one, where we're saying, don't go deep until you understand the whole thing, right? So this is probably one lesson learned. What else came up? How did it feel while you did this? Anything else? Teamwork. You need those specialists. I think this is that part where Naresh said, everyone has done their job and now get together. So this is collaboration, even as per Naresh's definition. So analyzing. So how did that analyzing go? Did we have to analyze a lot or just enough? Or? A lot? What is confusing? Guess why I didn't include the trainer? No, I have no reason to minimize myself at this point because I want to see the whole thing end to end. But the thing is that this system is not gonna care about who the trainer is, right? The only two users that I have in the system is the administrator and the employee. Trainers have no need to do anything in the system. Trainer is the one that does the training, but the training is face-to-face, does not use the system. So from that point of view, the trainer is not my user. I don't care about the trainer. Well, I do, but... Exactly, he's not using my app, right? So that is one, that is why this one focused me. That's why I was saying you need to use both goal and user at the same time because they keep you focused. Otherwise, you go in so many directions and you get lost. Something else. Anything else that came up? That's a good thing or a bad thing? Yeah. So visualization, we're talking about how you visualize the whole thing, and that is one of the strengths of story mapping. It's called, you see the forest and the trees. You can see the whole forest, you can see the whole story, everything end to end, and then at any moment, at any time, you can go deep down to one tree, to one story. It's not lost, right? You don't have that anxiety that some people say, hey, I know about this story, right? And you're like, if you don't put it in there, if you don't relate it to the rest of the goals and the activities, it gets lost. But like this, we put it. It is there. Everyone has given their ideas. Everyone has given their point of views. So you have it all in there. And it is all in well organized in this matrix. So I hope you enjoyed this part because we're going to use the same story map that you started. We're going to use it again later on. Yes. Yes, we do have tools to do this. They're called stickies and sharpies. So you can. I think for teams that work remotely and they need to do this, there is a cardboard, I think it's called, and Jeff Patton. Yeah, that one, storyboard. So there are some digital tools, But the power of this is to do it face to face. I've done this with 48 people in the room. In a half a day, we're able to plan out a project for 6 months. And they were all specialists that knew only one area. They knew only this part of the whole system, right? And together, when we started doing, we laid down first the big picture, and then when we wanted to go deeper and deeper in two sections, everyone brought their point of view, and it was beautiful because we ended up with, like, you're gonna see a picture at the end of the story map that we created. So, okay, beautiful. We have now story mapping. We did it. You know what is this? This is your project backlog, but it is organized. And you know what else? You don't need to write those stories, those yellow ones, you don't need to write them in that format, as a user, I want something so that. Because you already have the user and you already have the so that. The user and the goal are there. All you have is that nutshell that you want to do, right? So it is also, it helps the conversation. You don't need to go through the whole format, long form, repetition and all of that. You just focus on the important part. Okay, so now what we do, we take this and we said, okay, dear product owner, you gave us the goals, you gave us the user, designers brought all the UX experience to us. We build all this technical team, product owner, designers all worked together and created the stories. So we have now this nice, beautiful backlog. What do we do with that? The usual thing we do, we put the product owner on the spot and say, prioritize this for us. And sometimes product owner is like, what do I do? It's like that light that is in front of my eyes, right? That totally like, okay, I don't know what to do with this. And the whole team is looking at that product owner and expect the product owner to know everything. So there are different tools that product owners can use to help themselves and the teams on how to identify out of this big story map what are the things that are really important. And I'm going to show you three, but I'm going to work on one more than the other. So one way is the $100 allocation. This, first time I've heard about this is when I was working at a company that created a product for Pixar. Pixar is the movie company that does animations. And what they did there, they took stakeholders, the team took the stakeholders, they said, okay, these are the things you ask from us, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 features. You have $100. How much each of these features costs for you? How much would you pay for each of these features? And like that, you put the product owner on directly on that return of investment mindset, because you are giving them the investment part and you're saying to them, which one of these features gives you the highest return on this investment? And the other thing is it forces, if you have more than one product owner, and usually there are more than one product owner because there are multiple stakeholders and you need to pool from all of them, it forces them to talk with each other. It forces them to, you know what, I think this one, it's important. And the other guy goes, well, no, because for my organization, this one is important. Well, which one is more important for the whole company? It's not about just one side of the business or the other side of the business. It's about the company together. So it forces them to look from the bigger picture and to define out of all these features, what is the most important for the organization. Here it is an example on how someone can allocate $100 when they are going to buy a new car. Based on the priorities, I see that this person is a family person because they put priorities on savings, on the gas, and they need a four-door car. They don't need a two-door sporty, I don't care how much gas spends, I can go around and don't care, right? So from this, I see that is a family person. And is looking on saving and looking on costing, is looking for a car that is economical, right? So depending who you are, you prioritize these features differently. And this is what we do with stakeholders. Depending what your business is, depending what the goals of the companies are, what is the most important? There are some sheets here I have printed. At the end, you can come and pick up one. I have a little bit more explanations for each of these, for this, to explain it more if you want to read it after. Another model that I suggest to product owners to use is the Kanban model. Anyone seen this before? Agile coaches, of course. So Kano was a Japanese professor, and he came up to this model because he wanted to prove that not for everything, more is better. So what he found was that we have different type of features on a product. Some features are the must be. We cannot call that a product if that feature is not there. We cannot even send it out to any customer. We cannot put it on market. For example, a car has four wheels. Nobody goes to a dealership to buy a car and says, I want a car, and I want it to have four wheels, and I want it to have a steering wheel. No, it is understood that a car has four wheels, right? If a car doesn't have those four wheels, I'm not even considering to buy it. So these are the must-be features. And these are the features that they need to be there, and the customer, if they are not there, the customer is not happy at all. But when they're there, they're expected, so no big deal, right? So these are, you can see on the feature complete, how complete is the feature, or how when the feature is missing. So you can see when the feature is missing, the customer is very dissatisfied. The second type of features are the performance features. This is where now we are in competition. This is where my car is better than your car. This is where my car spends less gas than your car. This is where, I don't know, my phone is better than your phone, right? So this is the competition. This is where now we are in market. We have the features, but we are competing. And this is where more is better, because now we get clients to come to us because we provide better results, better robust features and all of that, right? The next one is the delighters. Delighters are the features that the customer has no idea that they might exist, but when they see them, they love them. A very good example, I don't know if you have seen it, is Mike Cohn that says his wife, long time ago, was shopping for a car. And she went to dealership one and she found the car that had everything she wanted to see in a car. But she said, you know what, I want to go and see some other cars. So they went to this other dealership and she saw a car that did not have everything she wanted, but she had cup holders. This car, she could put her Coke and it stays there, and it was beautiful. It was, as I said, long time ago when cars didn't have cup holders. She was so torn between these two cars just because this one had this delighter feature. She forgot about the car that had everything she wanted, and she wanted this one just because it had this delighter. So she was like, okay, I don't know what to do. I don't know which one to buy. And she didn't buy any car until that other, the dealership, the company that had everything she wanted, came up with a new model that had the cup holder, and then she bought the car. So these are the delighters. These are those features that sometimes some customers don't even wait for it to be ready. They buy your car just because it had that, or they buy your product just because it has that feature. So product owners can start looking at the features that they create like this. Out of all the story map they created, out of all these features, they can start defining what is a must, what is a performance, and what is a delighter. Again, there are more. I do have some handouts on this. Come after and pick one if you are more interested on this model. The other model is the value point, and this is the one that we're going to use on the story mapping that we created, that we started. So what we do with this, the value point, We start from the goal, we break that down, right? Just like we have it right now, we have that broken down into stories. And we start deciding some points. The goal is you're gonna have 1,000 points that are gonna be split on all the goals on your story map. So for example, you have 3 or 4 goals. Split 1,000 points on these goals and decide which one is more important and which one is less. Then you start taking that from the goal and you start breaking it down into activities. So the sum of all the activities need to sum up the value of the goal, right? So in this case, for example, activity 2 is really important. The other ones, less, right? And then you take that and you break it down into stories to decide which one of these stories is really important. Again, the value needs to add up to the goal number. So this is a simple way that forces a little bit the product owner to think now value. Where is this value out of all this story map, out of this forest that I created? Which one are those trees that are really important, that define this product that we're building? Oh, whoa. Where was I? So I'm gonna take you through the exercise of how I put points into the taxi app that I did. So out of 1,000 points, the way I thought is that requesting a booking is very important. I want people to start requesting taxi rides from my app. So I put there 500 stories. Selecting a taxi is the next most important for me because soon I'm gonna have my own company that has taxis, right? And that is gonna give me more revenue. Right now, I have a list of companies that are partners, right? I give those choices to my customer and they can pick and I get some percentage out of all the sales that I do. The payment, it is the least important. Why? Because it can be dealt with the driver right now. If I know that I'm giving a business that my customer has a ride and gets a taxi, I know that at some point that taxi driver is not gonna let that person go without money, right? And right now the taxi driver has a way to get money out of the customer, so I am not too worried about the payment. I know it's gonna happen somehow, but I want to get to there. So that's why I put more points on the requesting. And then I started breaking that down into activities, and as you can see, again, with that mindset, I put more points into the activities that were very important for me. And then I broke that down into stories. As you can see, they always end up with the same business value that I ended up to put on the goal. So this is a simple math, but it just helps with figuring out the most important thing, with that prioritization, if we want to say. Very often, you're going to find that some of those stories there will end up with 0 points. You haven't even started developing. And right away, you can notice that some of those have very little value. Is it worth spending time on analyzing or working on those yet? No, right? Why are we talking about something that has 10-point value when I have something that has 100 or 150. So from here, we need now to consider even the size. Okay, we have this business value, but what happens if the story that has a high business value is very big in size? Right? I have a story that has 150 business points, but it takes 2 months to be done. And I have a story that has 100 points and it takes 2 weeks to be done. Which one should I pick? 2 weeks, I'm hearing here. 2 weeks? Makes sense. Who thinks I should pick the 2 month one? Anyone? No? No? It does make sense. You? Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can break it down if we want. And when we break it down, yeah. So, and if we break it down, then the two stories, for example, we break it down into two or three, they need to add up into the sum of this one. And then again, you need to choose the highest value out of all these, right? And again, what's going on there? You are taking out of this big story that you had, you're narrowing down to the really core function that really brings the value out of all this. So you're removing all the fluff and you're getting into the core of it. But it just, the size matters. That's the point. The size helps us make decisions. The size helps us either break it down or choose something else. How do we get the size? The product owners usually ask the technical team. Because technical teams can say a high level size of the work that is to be done. Without going in too much details, I know you probably use story points a lot, but I don't want to go too much into details because right now, again, we are in a very high level. We are story mapping, right? Again, the stories that we created are just ideas that we thought. So without going into much detail, we can give a sense of a medium, large, or extra large or small. So just like a t-shirt sizing, or I don't know if you are familiar even with a coffee cup sizing, right? Where the sizes are relative. The sizes doesn't mean that the medium is two smalls, right? The medium is just a little bigger than the small. The large is just a little bigger than the medium, but they're not exactly like two times or three times bigger than each other. They are relative. So from that point of view, the product owner can get that kind of sizing from the technical team to make a decision now what's going on. Any questions so far? Yes. So these are two, as I said, there are two different, actually three different ways to help the product owner. The $100 allocation was one way. The Kano model was one way. The value point is one way. This one we're using just the value point. Not always, because we're looking, value point is not always, in case you are not listening, we have the question here that value point is always proportional with the dollar value, right? Not always, because we can find a story that has a really high value and impact, but it doesn't cost much to do it, right? This is where I said the size matters, because if we consider now something that has a high value, 150 points but takes 2 months, and something that is 100 points but takes 2 weeks, we're choosing the smaller one because it costs less and we get that return on that investment faster. So it's not always, it doesn't mean always they're equal. Uh-huh. No. Yeah. So when we estimate, the question is, when we estimate, we usually use the time it takes to complete. Is that the right thing? I'd say no. Time is only one of the factors that we use on the estimation. So when we estimate the time, we estimate the effort, we estimate the complexity, we estimate the unknowns. So we estimate a lot of things. Risk, big. We take all of these in consideration, and then we make a decision of the size. It's a really good article, Mike Cohn has, when he explained how the story points work. He says, for example, if I want to move from here to there, it is pretty simple and straightforward, I'm walking. And that's one point. The distance stays the same, but if in between there now, it's a big, deep hole, that adds risk, because now I have to jump and I have to prepare myself. So that's adding more complexity, more effort for me. I'm not just walking, I need now to jump. And if it's a volcano, it's even more complex, right? So it's not just the time. Time is only one of the factors that you need to consider. Make sense? We need to consider more. Risk is really high, right? What do we do in Agile? We work with highest risks first because we learn from them. So you need to consider that. What we do now, when we do now is, from this story map that we have, we come up with the minimum viable product. So this is where now we said that product owner is gonna start now prioritizing and helping. How are we gonna get out of all this big backlog that we created? Minimum viable product. Have you heard this term before? Yeah, everyone, yeah. I'm pretty sure you have. If you're here, you have heard that. So, minimum viable product is the smallest set of stories that when put together, give value to the product, to the users. And users can use that. Users can give us some feedback. We can learn out of it. So when we decide what to do next, we do it based on feedback. But it has to be small, because we want to learn quick, we want to learn fast. If it is big, we have to wait a long time to learn, and we are making a lot of problems. We are creating a lot of, we are creating a product that we don't know if we are creating the right one. So, out of all of this, we need to create that feature sets. We need to get out of all of this story mapping, out of all these features that we created, that set of features that are gonna give us those minimum viable product. Another way that is used, depending on the industry, depending on the context that you are, is the minimally marketable feature set. Again, what is minimal? You can see those cars. Minimal is something that has four wheels in this case and can go forward. And then you can add more into that. You can come up to the Hummer. You don't need the Hummer right away if you haven't proven that it's moving forward, right? So you need that small, minimal one that gives you a little bit of feedback. A friend of mine, Matt Barcombe, he came up with Smurfs. It's easy to remember. It's easy to refer to it. You guys are familiar with Smurfs? Those little blue creatures, cartoons for kids. Smurfs, yes. And specifically marketable, understandably reasonable feature sets. So what do we do here? It is marketable. We can put it in the market. It has some of those must features that we said from the Kanon model, right? Understandably reasonable. we're not making something huge, something really expensive. We're making something that is reasonable and it gives us feedback. Feature sets. You don't have to do just one feature. You might need to do a set of features that, when working together, give some value to the user. So I want you now to think about what are we going to do, how are we going to use this in an existing system? Yeah, it's beautiful. We're starting a new project, we're starting a new application. It is all cool and beautiful. What about legacy systems? What about systems that we need to maintain? Any idea? Can we use story mapping for that? Can we use this minimum viable product for those? He's saying yes. Any no's? Anyone thinks that no, it doesn't work? What? But still, Kanban needs someone to say, what is the next feature to work on? So Kanban is just a process that we use. Kanban is not going to help product owner to choose, to prioritize, to order features. Yeah? Yeah. 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 Uh-huh. Yeah, it is an existing system, but it's coming up with a lot of issues from production. Adding or fixing, right? So it is not about just we have a system that is already working. It's about keeping the system going, keeping the system still valuable for customers. So the answer is yes. We can still use story mapping for that. And the way it works, even the feature set mindset, right? The way it works is, again, you find the smallest valuable feature. Out of all the things that the customers are complaining, which one is the smallest change that is going to bring a lot of value? Out of all the phone calls that our support team gets, 80% of those are probably for one feature, believe it or not. If you fix that one, you decrease the number of support calls, right? So you're saving in a way, but you're making your system even more nice for your customers, for your end users. So pick those, find the areas where the system is going to get better, more robust, with the customer in mind, with the end customer in mind. Another thing is to deliver to users and gather feedback. So yes, you think you are fixing now something. Do you really fix it? Do you know that? So you need to get that feedback. And the feedback comes from either surveys, other analytics, other support calls, other operations, right? So there are different ways that you gather this feedback, that you gather this information on your change. But you need that, right? You learn from those, and those are the ones that help you make decisions. And the next thing we do, we repeat. You don't do this once. You continually do this. You make one change, you learn from it, now you do it again. Now you go through again, through find the smallest valuable feature, make the smallest change and get the feedback, repeat again. So you can use the same thing even with the legacy system. So I want you now to go back. And we're going to do another exercise. We're going to continue on the story mapping that you started. And what we're going to do is we're going to create now this MVPs. We're going to create MVPs for the story map that you started. Here it is, one way that I started. Out of all of these, I decided that scheduling time and choosing the pickup location are very important for me. But what I need there right now, just to prove my app, I'm picking only the immediate pickup and to enter the location. I'm not asking about the GPS to find the location of the customer. I'm saying, customer, please type your location. When it comes to no smartphone, I'm gonna leave that group for now. Most of the people have smartphone. I need to take care of these people, but not right now. When it comes to online availability, I select taxis available from the taxi company. I'm not caring too much about the online not available, so I'm not going to select from all the available taxis. On the payment, I'm choosing these. In-app secure payments and get receipt by email. This is my first MVP. As you can see, I chose the ones that had high business value that helped me, right? The value points helped me. And I chose also one here, one that had really small 35 points. But what it does, if we go back to that feature set, it makes the user experience more valuable, more meaningful, more exciting, right? So I choose all the highest business values and I choose something that it is small, but it makes the my first MVP more complete. With the same mindset, I also chose the other two MVPs. So right now what I have, I've broken my story mapping into MVPs. I want you to do the same with your story mapping. You're gonna have 15 minutes. But right now I'm not considering those users. Right now I'm not considering the users that need GPS. Right now I'm saying just enter. Later on I add the GPS. But in this case I don't need it. Well, then you pull it. Then you use it. So if a story cannot be used, then you pull it. You pull the next story that needs to go with it. But usually, we are going then out of the concept of what a story is. Story is invest, and the I stands for independent. Yeah. So one thing, if you look at the story map, story map takes care of dependencies, because in order for me to get to the receipt by email, I need to do something before it. So by the time I'm at the story here, I have considered all the stories that I need to do on different system, on different steps, in order to get here. So dependencies are taken care of when I go horizontally and I slice that MVP, right? So this is now where we take in consideration everything that we have put, but we are looking horizontally. In order to achieve this goal, what do I need to pull? So you have now 13 minutes to do your MVPs. Yes. Sorry? Oh, earned business value. EBV stands for earned business value, right? You can see out of each MVP how my business value increases, is created. Yeah, so you need to start putting points and then you need to start drilling down. Yes. It is. The very first MVP there, the horizontal, is immediate pickup, enter location, select available text. Okay, so that is my first. No. So MVPs are horizontal. Yes. No. Exactly. So that is when I start considering the technical input, if they've told me. In this case, I'm considering they are more or less the same value, the same estimation. Yes. Yes. So that's why we said the size matters, because it helps. Yeah. Not the costing, the effort. Yes. And then you create the MVP based on that combination. Business value plus effort. And I say, line them up. You guys, so give me your MVP. You didn't choose this, right? You chose another one. Okay, give me a sense of your product, your first MVP. What are you gonna do? No, just the first MVP. All I care is the first MVP. Okay. Basic. Just so you see something created, right? So they're creating a schedule for a conference, and they're just going to do them just the minimum just to create a session and to and register for that session. Okay, who has the first MVP for this one? Okay, what do you guys got? What is your first MVP? Registration? Uh-huh. Participant attendance complete the training, no feedback? Oral, good. Good. We need feedback, but you are not writing code for it, right? You are giving them a piece of paper. Complete the piece of paper before you leave. Wonderful. What is your MVP? Much bigger? Can we make it smaller? It has to be minimum. Okay, so you get a sense. I hope the conversation there was more important than what you came up. And there is not one right question, the one right answer, right? Everyone, considering the team that you have, considering the where you are, considering the complexity of the systems that you have, you choose what makes sense for you. But think small, think minimal. If you can do something manual at the beginning, do manual, because manual is cheaper than writing code. As long as it gives you feedback, as long as you learn from it, don't spend time with the code. Write a piece of paper, it's good. So this is one way. So you kind of finished your story map, right? I wanted you to review it and get done with the first MVP, so we went through this. I want you to get a little bit of sense of why are we thinking like this. If we look between value and time, and if we're trying to get the return on this investment that we're doing, at the beginning, as you saw, we chose the highest value, right? We work on the most wonderful, valuable thing that we have chosen. After that, the MVP 2, if you looked at the story map that I had, the first MVP had a very high earned business value. The second MVP had a lower business value. I'm going to go back just to show you that. Here. See? The first MVP has 450 earned business value. The second one is 420, and the third one is 130. Right? So as you can see, the business value that we earn keeps going down because we work on less valuable set of features. It comes to a point where we're saying the time, the cost of the team is the same. For example, in a sprint, 2 weeks, The cost of the team stays the same, but the value is going down. Is it worth it to put money on a feature that is going to cost us as much to create as it did the very first one, but the return is going to be really low? Is it? It is not worth it. Unless we would have put in more money, more business value on it, right? And this is where we start now discussing and being smart about what we choose to do. Usually what we do is, in a traditional way, a team has a set of projects lined up. They have project one, project two, project three, project four. And what do? We start with project one. We do every single story on project one. That is done. Now we move to project two. Every single story in project two. Guess what's going on with project three and four? We run out of money. It's not gonna go. Maybe they are important. So how about we look at them all at the same time? We do the story mapping for them. We start creating all of the goals. And out of, for example, project one, if we have a situation like this, we choose what we're gonna do. We pick the highest value on project one. That, and maybe even that, because it's a high value story. Rather than continue on working on project one on very low valuable features for the same cost of the team, maybe we can go to project two. And we can see what's going on project two. Meanwhile, all the customers of the project one are enjoying the features that we have delivered, those high value features. We are getting some feedback out of them. The product owner is saying, that thing that we did, that first MVP on the project one, you know what? We just need to do just a little bit more change on that, but it's pretty good. We don't need to do all the rest that we thought we would do. Meanwhile, the team is working on project two and is starting creating more value there. At the end of the project two, right, we can say, which one do we want? Do we want to continue with the features that we left from project one? Or do we want to continue with the features left from project two? Or do we want to move to project three? It is all now based on learnings. We have made the decision because we learned. There is also one thing. This is a story map that I did with the team, that 48 people team that I mentioned at the beginning. You can see how many stickies are there, right? We started putting them under each other because we didn't have enough space. One thing that I always tell product owners is, you are never, ever gonna burn down the whole backlog, because sometimes it just doesn't make sense to invest on something that gives you very little business value for the cost. Maybe you can find workaround, maybe you can live without it, but you don't need to. And don't invest too much time in analyzing, into going too much deeper into those stories and prepare a lot of acceptance criteria and all of that if you think that it is not gonna be worth working on it. Put your efforts only on the one that bring value. Work on those, learn from those, and then move on to the next set of valuable features. Questions. We are really tight with time. How am I doing with time? Very little, huh? Am I over time? Okay. It is time up, no more? Okay. I'm gonna be around. Catch me, and we can answer. Thank you.